Okay, good morning, everybody. It's great to be with you again. Sunday morning, June the 7th, 2020. God is here. What a beautiful day the Lord has given us today. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it and be glad in Him. Lord, we bless you today. We give you praise and honor and glory. Thank you for your love for us, that your love never fails. Lord, you've drawn us out of darkness into your marvelous light. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness to us. Day by day, you sustain us and keep us. We can dwell in your presence every day. Holy Spirit, we worship you today. We ask you to come and to guide this meeting. And Father, I pray that that your Holy Spirit will touch the heart of every person who joins in this recording, in this video, in this live stream. Father, that you would heal us in real time. And Lord, we want to give you praise. You are worthy. Hallelujah. You are worthy, Lord God. Hallelujah. Slava and glory. Glory to the name of the Lord. I want to explain, we're going to sing some old psalms today. And some of them are so old they might be new to you. And because we're live, we don't have the words over the top. But I hope you'll be able to pick up the words. And one of the things that, well, anybody that I've spoken to in the last 6 months will know that I've had this thing that old songs seem to be reaching their prophetic fulfillment in this present day. Actually, this has been going on with me for a couple of years. But songs from even decades ago are now ready for fulfillment through the church in the earth, the kingdom of God advancing. And so, so this first one really speaks to that. It's interesting how the song that speaks about the church rising up, first and last of the worship songs this morning. So anyway, I hope that if you know the songs, worship along with us. Please pour out your heart to God and keep your eyes fixed on Him. If you don't know the songs, I hope that you'll be able to hear the words and pay attention and realize the message of each song. That there is this prophetic slant to them, this prophetic edge. So I hope you'll take it in, it'll bless your hearts. And I hope that you'll be blessed this morning, or whenever you're watching this video, by the Father who loves you with an everlasting love, who never leaves you, he'll never forsake you, who's always on your side working for you. Bless you today.
Kindle the flame of passion, and I will let it grow in me.
prophetic word that was given quite a long time ago now, related to this next song. This can happen anyway. The word was that when this song is sung, a time's going to come that people will be healed spontaneously. You need a healing touch from the Lord today, right now. Just look to Him, the author and perfecter of our faith, the Lord our healer.
Turn your eyes upon me,
things that is the characteristic, a strong characteristic of the kingdom of God is the fellowship of the saints. That God has made us to be a people, that we are part of one body, with one Lord, one faith, one baptism. So, we don't normally sing old songs all the time, but these old songs today, particularly that one, for some reason, has just taken me back to our roots. So I want to give a mention to our roots. we've got one more song to sing, and it's very old. And this is one of those songs that for 2 years or more has been just on my mind. I hope I can get through it without blubbering. I'll try. And the words are just so profound. For this day, I believe. So I hope I can get the words out so that you can distinguish them. This is a song by a guy named Ronnie Wilson. I don't really know anything about him. I just know that it's a song that was sung at the Dales Bible Week or the Stoney Bible Conference or one of those things so long ago, decades and decades, 30 years ago or more than 30 years. And the chorus is based on the psalm, it's all based on the psalm. My tongue will be the pen of a ready writer. What the Father gives to me, I'll sing. I only want to be his breath. I only want to glorify the King. So it's about the church. I pray that it's prophetic and that it's the word for the day for the church in this nation and around the world. The Spirit is on the move. Sound of rustling in the leaves of the trees. The Spirit of the Lord has come down on the earth. The church that seemed in slumber. really pleased to say today to say that John Matthew's going to preach, and I'm sure he's got a great word for us. So, no announcements, there's no offering. Well, yeah, what do we do about that? Okay. So let's pray for a GM here. Father, thank you for this man of God. I pray you bless him this morning as he brings your word, that it'll be cohesive and coherent, and that the anointing of your spirit will be on him, Lord God, the mantle that you've placed on him. And let him bring forth your word with power, Father God, speaking to us to equip us, to assure us, to feed us and to help us, Lord. Father, we want to receive what you have to say to us this morning. So bless John, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Do I need this?
Yeah.
Great.
Well, good morning. This is the part where you're all supposed to shout good morning back. So I'm going to assume that you're doing that in your homes, that you are engaged, and that you are working along with us through the word this morning. Glad to be sharing with you. And God's amazing. God is really great to us, and he has great things in mind for us. And I know that he's at work reshaping us to be conformed to the image of Jesus so that we can reflect Jesus more and more and more. And so I'm trusting that we're going to find something in the Word this morning that will challenge us and shape us and encourage us. And this morning we're going to be narrowing in on just one verse of Scripture. And perhaps over the course of several weeks together, we'll work our way through that verse, word by word. And so just in the interest of forthrightness, I'm going to tell you right up front that we're only going to be getting to one phrase in one verse in one psalm this morning. But it's one of my favorite verses, and it's a really significant word that we're going to be examining and studying and chewing on this morning. And so if you have a Bible, you can think about getting that. We're going to be turning to Psalm 145, verse 8, and it might sound familiar to you a little bit. I would hope that you have heard this somewhere before. It's repeated throughout the word. It's in Psalm 145, verse 8. It's also found in Psalm 103, Psalm 86, James 5. It's in Nehemiah. It's elsewhere. And it's this running theme through the Bible that we're going to examine in Psalm 145 today. And this is why we're going there. This is something that God often puts on my heart. Two big themes that I often find myself sharing about. Two things that affect the way we live our lives more than anything else. Two big important ideas that sway our decisions, that affect our choices, that color our interactions with people, that shape our behavior and dictate the way that we view and think about the world generally speaking. They influence our attitudes, everything. They're all encompassing. Two really big things that affect life more than anything else. The first one is this: our perspective on God, our concept of what God is like. Who is he? What's he like? What does he think about me? How does he think? What are his intentions for me and for us? That's the first thing. What do I think about God? What do I know about God? And then the second big idea is my understanding of my identity in Jesus, my perspective of myself because of what Jesus has done to change me. What is your understanding of your identity? Who are you? Who has God made you to be? What is the truth of your identity because of Jesus' work on the cross? How are you different and changed and redeemed and restored and recreated? What's your position in him? What's your authority in him? What is the current spiritual state of your being because you belong to Jesus? Who are you? These two things shape and affect life more than anything else, because they affect the way we approach things, the way we deal with circumstances, the way that we think about and love people, the way that we persevere and endure under trial, all sorts of things. And so these are the two big questions: what is God like and who am I? They're seriously significant. few weeks ago, I was sharing from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 to 21. We were talking about being an ambassador for God. It's this role that God has bestowed on us as part of our identity in Him. It's a call to represent Him in the earth. And it comes out of the truth that we've been fundamentally changed, that we've been totally recreated by grace through faith. And the truth that at the core of who you are right now, the truth is that who I am at the core right now, we are entirely transformed by the finished work of Jesus. And so we can rest secure knowing that we are saints by calling, that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, that we're made holy and righteous and good because Jesus has absorbed the punishment and the wrath that was rightfully ours. He got our sin. We got eternal life. We got a brand new trajectory and a brand new identity in Him. And now we get to carry Him to the world as His ambassadors. We get to have the ministry of reconciliation to the world, bringing Jesus to people and bringing people to Jesus. And it's amazing what He's done for us. And today I want to consider and hopefully start to answer something about the other big question. What is God like? And Psalm 145, verse 8 is the epitome of the answer to this question. It's deep and clear, and it's a searchable answer, and so it's good to explore it together. And so in a minute, we're going to read all of Psalm 145 and then dig into verse 8. So if you do have a Bible in your home, this is a good opportunity to go and get it. And if you want to just open a new tab and read along at BibleGateway.com, that's an okay way to do it as well. And just before we read, I want to give you a tiny bit of background to this psalm. This is not extensive by any means, but I'm hopeful that this will be some kind of point of consideration for our conversation today. Psalm 145 is a song that David wrote. It's a beautiful song, one of more than 70 songs that David wrote. It's an acrostic poem, so each stanza begins with a letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And the inscription to this song, the introduction before you actually get to the song, the thing that David wrote about this particular song is that this is David's song of praise. There are lots of psalms that are attributed to David, but this is the only one that says it this way. It's as if David has said, this one is mine. This is my personal reflection, my personal response to God. This is the one that captures my heart as I think about God and I return worship and adoration and praise to Him. This one is the one that captures my heart. And the words of this particular song show us how David sees God, and how David knows God, and how David has experienced God in some way. And it shows us why David's affection overflows. And verse 8 is the heart and soul of it. It's the core of why David responds like he does. Verse 8 gives us the why of why David sings what he sings. And so with that in mind, let's turn to Psalm 145, and we're going to read it top to bottom. Psalm 145 says, I will exalt you, my God the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will commend your works to another. They will tell of your mighty acts. They will speak of your glorious splendor, of your majesty. And I will meditate on your wonderful works. They will tell of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They will celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made. All you have made will praise you, O Lord. Your saints will extol you. They will tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might, so that all men may know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is faithful to all his promises and loving toward all he has made. Verse 14, the Lord upholds all those who fall and lifts up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand, and you satisfy the desires of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and loving toward all he has made. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cry, and he saves them. The Lord watches over all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Let every creature praise his holy name forever and ever. It's amazing. I love it. It's one of my favorites. And verse 8, we share this one at home a lot. Verse 8, the Lord is gracious and he's compassionate. He's slow to anger and he's rich in loving kindness. Pretty much for the rest of our time, we'll be narrowing in on that title that we find for God in verse 8, the Lord. I wonder what you think of when you hear the word Lord. And I wonder if you ever think of it beyond a biblical context. I don't often, but there are some applications. There are some times that we hear that word. Maybe you have some British connection, and so, or maybe even better than that, you've been totally swept away by Downton Abbey. And I didn't get swept away by Downton Abbey, but you know there is a hierarchy of nobility in Britain where royalty and upper class people inherit or have bestowed on them, have conferred to them these titles and these privileges because of their position. Dukes and marquises and viscounts and barons, people who hold these kinds of titles collectively have been called lords and ladies, except for dukes who are called your grace. Doesn't matter. It's like Lord is the catch-all title for these people who have power and the people who call the shots, the people who are the ones who dictate politics, who run their property, who tell their servants what to do. They're high society and they're high profile. They're the ones who are supposed to be in places of honor and people who are in charge, who have authority, who have influence. A Lord is the master of their domain. Sometimes when I've talked about this idea with people, the idea of a landlord comes to mind. And so the landlord is often the owner of a property, but even if they're not the owner, the landlord is the person who takes care of the property, they're responsible for the property, they decide who can come and stay, who has to go, they collect the money. And while it might not always feel like it, they're supposed to be in charge. The landlord oversees the land that people are living on. How about the Lord of the Rings? This furry-footed little dude has authority over the destiny of this really powerful ring. I won't tell you because that would be spoiling the movie for you. Lord of the Rings. All of these things point to a similar kind of position and a similar kind of role. Kind of like the dictionary definition, which says someone or something having power, authority, influence. A master or a ruler. And here in Psalm 145, verse 8, we find this title for God, the Lord. It's what David has chosen to call the God that he knows and loves, the Lord. And in fact, we're going to find shortly that this is actually a title, a name that God gave to himself. I am the Lord. So I wonder, do any of those things sound like God, the Lord God? Is he the master? Is he the one in charge? Is he exalted? Is he in a position of honor? Does he have power and influence and authority? Absolutely. That's God. We sometimes say he's omniscient. That means he knows everything. We say he's omnipresent. He's everywhere all at the same time. He's omnipotent, which means he has all the power. And in terms of being a lord and a master and a person with influence and authority, that's top tier. There isn't anyone better. There's no better kind of lord or master. He's as good as it gets. And there is no other master or other lord like him. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That means he is the master of people who are in positions of influence and leadership. Joshua 3 tells us that God is the Lord of all the earth. The whole world is under his authority and his dominion. Or we can think about this passage from Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 to 11. You may have heard it. It says, "For this reason also God highly exalted him, Jesus, and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that he is." This is the part where if you were in the room, I would expect you to go, "Lord," and you can shout that in your living room, because...
Lord.
Yeah. To the glory of God the Father. He's the Lord. He's the Master. And so I have to ask the question, are you living under the authority and the dominion and the leadership and the lordship of God? I mean, in an ongoing and a persistent kind of way, in an intentional way, are you allowing him to lead you and direct you? Are you letting him call the shots in your life? Are you surrendered to him and walking with open hands to his direction and his redirection, to his command and his correction? We have to think about these things. As I was studying and reflecting on this word, the Lord, and thinking about that dictionary definition, I became aware of that word in the definition, something. It says someone or something having power or authority or influence. And you know, there are things that get in the way of us following God sometimes. There are things that we submit ourselves to and that we allow to master us that aren't God. Sometimes it's people and it's relationships, but sometimes it's things that master us. Some people are mastered by drugs, and some people are mastered by alcohol, and some people are mastered by gossip, and some people are mastered by fear, and some people are mastered by lust or greed or desire. It's not always people that master us. And it's not always God that masters us. It's not always God that we submit to and surrender to. It's not always God that gets to call the shots. And yet, Jesus is Lord of all. God is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And his desire is that we would submit ourselves to him, that we would surrender our days and our thinking and our plans and our hearts and our desires to him. His desire is that we wouldn't be mastered by anything, but that we would walk in his freedom under his lordship and under his authority and under his protection. He's the Lord. And so we should honor him as such, and we should be subject to him as such. For some people, that's a really scary proposition. And so I do want to be really clear. When we say we're giving in to God, we're surrendering to God, we aren't giving ourselves over to a God who lords it over people, excuse the pun. We're not talking about a God who badgers and harasses. We're not talking about a God who just stands there yelling at you to get his own way. He doesn't coerce and he's not abusive. That's not God. So this is where it's important to ask that question again. What is your concept of God? What's he really like? And when you're on your worst day, how does he respond to you? If we read our verse again, this is what we find. The Lord, the Master, the King, he's gracious, and he's compassionate, and he's patient because he's slow to get angry. He's overflowing, he's rich in loving kindness. And so we don't surrender to a God who's out to get us. We don't surrender to a God who's going to beat us down. Instead, we surrender to a God of love, 1 John 4:8. We surrender to a God who has our best in mind, Psalm 115:12. We surrender to a God who designs a great and preferred future for each of us, Jeremiah 29:11. We surrender to a God who desires to conform us to the image of the risen Savior, Romans 8:29. We surrender to a God who cares so deeply for us that he would go to any length to make us his own. Isaiah 40:11, Psalm 23, 1 Peter 5, 6, and 7, pretty much the whole Bible. If you just read it, you'll find him there. And so I ask the question, are we living in surrender to God, who is the Lord? Maybe I should ask it again and ask, can you surrender to that kind of God? Can you come under the authority and the leadership and the command and the correction of a God who loves you and who is compassionate towards you, who has great things in mind for you, who cares so deeply for you? Can you submit to a God who wants the absolute best for you? You know, it's entirely likely that there are things that God is already talking with you about, that he wants to lead you in, where he wants to direct you or to influence you or to bring change. I think that God's talking with us all the time. Sometimes we just need to stop and listen and see what it is that he's saying. There are all sorts of things that he might be talking with us about. It could be a business deal, could be the way that you parent your kids, could be something about the relationships that you're keeping, could be something about an attitude that you're swinging with God or with people. Could be a preconceived idea that you have about the world that you live in. Could be any manner of different things that God has on the radar, because he is the Lord of all of it, and he sees it all. And so are we allowing him to lead? Are we allowing him to prompt us on those things? Are we listening for what he wants to say? And maybe you go, well, I'm not sure what kinds of things he might be saying, or I'm not sure how to hear or to recognize his voice. That's an okay place to start. And we're going to keep practicing and listening and waiting on him, because I am very, very confident that when we take the time to be still and to know that he's God, and we take the time to sit with him and to be with the Lord, he speaks to us, that he's eager and excited to reveal his heart to us. And we can learn and we can practice and we can discern what his voice sounds like in the midst of all the other things that are going on. And we can find out the kinds of things that he's saying. But if we aren't there where we can just hear that still small voice whispering to us, and sometimes even when we can, we can be sure that God has said some things very clearly, so clearly that he's written them down for us. And you can always be sure of God's will when it's printed in the Bible for us. So I'm going to encourage you to read your Bible. You might find things like this. How about your finances? Matthew 6:33 says, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else that you need will be added to you." Proverbs 19, verse 17 tells us, "Whoever is generous to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will repay him for his deed." 2 Corinthians 9, verses 6 and 7, "Whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will reap bountifully. Each one must give as they have decided in their heart," not reluctantly, not under compulsion. God loves a cheerful giver. How about being a person of integrity in your business? Proverbs 10, verse 9 says, "Whoever walks in integrity walks securely, but he who makes his ways crooked will be found out." Or Proverbs 11, 1 says, "A false balance and dishonest business practices are extremely offensive to the Lord, but an accurate scale is his delight." That's pretty plain, I think. Dishonest business practices are extremely offensive to the Lord. How about the friends that you keep? Proverbs 22, verses 24 to 27 says, "Make no friendship with a man given to anger, nor go about with a wrathful man, lest you learn his ways and entangle yourself in a snare. Be not one who gives a pledge, who who puts up security for debts if you have nothing with which to pay, why should your bed be taken from under you? Put a little more concisely, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33 says, do not be deceived. Bad company ruins good morals. How about parenting? How about kids learning to honor their parents? How about sex and sexuality? How about, you get the idea, it's all in there because God has revealed those things to us in his word. He's the Lord of all of it. He's the Lord of all things. And so what is God talking with you about? I want to encourage you to read your Bible and be still and to listen for his voice. Find out what he's got to say, what it is that he has in mind, how he wants to lead you and direct you in your life. He's happy to tell you. He's eager to be with you and reveal those things. He's eager to show you that he's a God of love and a God of compassion. So there, that's our start on the word Lord. But there's more to this one word than meets the eye. Because when your Bible shows you the word Lord in all caps, L-O-R-D, all caps, it's referring to a very particular Hebrew word. It's not just Lord like we would think of it. It's actually the word Yahweh. And the word Yahweh is God's covenant name. It's the special name that God gives to himself describe himself to his people. It's the name that he first reveals when he meets with Moses and they have that special encounter at the burning bush. Moses, who had lived his whole life as Egyptian royalty, he had grown up in a palace, had that incident where he killed an Egyptian slave master who was beating a Hebrew slave. And so he ran away and he's living on the backside of the desert. That's what the Bible says. And I think that's about as far away from anything that you can get. He's not living on the head of the desert. He's not living on the shoulder. He's living on the backside of the desert. Herding sheep. Chasing sheep around the desert. When he sees this bush that's on fire but not burning up. And it's God manifesting his presence, calling out to Moses, saying, come over here. And Moses talks with God, and God sends Moses back to Egypt to set God's people free. And Moses says, well, who will I tell them has sent me? And in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, God says to Moses, I am. He calls himself, I am who I am. He says, tell the people that I am Yahweh has sent you to them. You know that God is present tense, right? That God is now with us. He's absolute and he's consistent and he's faithful and he's always right in the middle of whatever it is that you're experiencing and living and going through, because he is I am right now present with you. God is not inclined to live in the past like some of us are. Some of us are prone to focus our attention on things that have happened before. And he was there with you when that situation happened, or he was with you when that circumstance unfolded. But he's not there anymore, because that moment is done and we're here and he's with you now. He is present here now. And he's not prone to live in the future where we sometimes live, in the anxiety of what might happen or the fear of the unknown. He's not there while we're thinking about the next encounter where we get to have revenge on somebody or whatever your imagination takes you to when you think about the future. He's here, present now. And at this moment, God, the Lord of all, who is compassionate and loving, I am. He has healing and wholeness and freedom and love. which is awesome. And we can rest in his present tense nature because it means that he's never far away from you. It means that he's never early and he's never late. He is. He's right here, right now with us. This is his name. It's a reflection of his nature and his character. But it's not just what he's called. It's who he is. Ever present, current, now, I am with you. Is that how you view God? I said before that nothing affects our way of life and the way that we interact with people in the world more than knowing what God is like and who he is and what he really thinks about me and who I am to him, what my identity is in him. I really believe that God wants us to know what he's like. He's happy and he's eager to reveal himself to us. And so as we read the scripture, we find that he expands his name, that he gives us an even bigger picture of what he's like and who he wants to be to us. He reveals his nature and character. He reveals it to Moses. In Exodus chapter 3, we read, I am has sent you. And then later in Exodus chapter 34, verses 6 and 7, this is what it says. The Lord passed by in front of Moses and he proclaimed his name. The Lord, Yahweh, I am. The Lord God, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in loving kindness and truth, who keeps loving kindness for thousands, who forgives iniquity, transgression, and sin. Wow! Does that sound familiar? Gracious and compassionate and slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness. That's our verse from today, Psalm 145, verse 8. I'm sure that David had been told this name. But even more than that, I think that David had learned something and had tasted something and experienced something of that same favor and grace and character of God. The same grace and favor, the same covenant that was evident when God stepped into Moses' life and situation. God is a covenant God. And this self-description is the beauty of his covenant. I am is his covenant name. It's a description of his nature towards us. It's amazing. In the weeks ahead, we might look at some of these things, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, rich in loving kindness, which is another covenant word. But this is what we need to keep in mind when we read the Lord, all caps, L-O-R-D, all capital letters. This is what that word is describing. Every time that you see that word in your Bible, the Lord, all caps, it's describing his nature and his character and his heart towards us. That he wants to be the Lord of all. He wants to be the Lord of our lives as a gracious and compassionate and patient, overflowing with love kind of God. This is the master. This is the ruler that we surrender to and we kneel before and we obey. So there, we scratch the surface on one word. That's what God's like. That's what he's really like. And I'm going to wrap up here, but before I go, I want to just ask the question one more time. Now that you've heard the greatness of God, and now that you've found him in Psalm 145, and you've heard his heart expressed to you through verse 8, now that you know he's ever present, he's covenant keeping, he's always gracious, he's always compassionate, he's always slow to anger and overflowing with love, and now that you know that he's for you and not against you, and that he has great things in mind for you because he thinks the entire world of you. And now that you know that he's big enough, and he's strong enough, and he's faithful enough to follow through on any promise or any direction that he gives you, knowing all these things, are you willing to walk in surrender to him? Are you you willing to allow him to be the Lord in your life and in your situation? Are you willing to sit down and have the conversation with him so that you can find his heart and allow him to meddle with your stuff? Are you willing to let him influence and recreate your situations and your thinking and your perspectives? I hope that the answer is yes. We only made it through one word this morning, but what a great word it was. He is the Lord. That's our God. He is the ruler, the creator, the sustainer, the master, the Lord, and he's awesome. And I hope that you find his heart today and that you're blessed. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your grace for us. Thank you for your kindness to us. Thank you that you are everything that we need for life and for godliness, that you have totally recreated us in your provision of Jesus and the cross. Jesus, sometimes it's scary or sometimes it's hard to surrender to you. Sometimes it's hard or it's scary to allow you to be the one who calls the shots. If we're honest, Jesus, we're a bunch of control freaks, really. But you're the Lord. You're the King of Kings, and you're the Lord of Lords. And you're gracious, and you're compassionate, and you're slow to anger, and you're rich in loving kindness. And so I pray that we would experience you that way, that we would taste and see that you're good, and that out of our experience with you and our relationship with you, we would surrender whatever it is that you bring to our attention. And we bless you, Jesus, because you're so good and you're so faithful. And we love you. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Love you, church. Have a great day. Have a great week. And we'll see you soon.